Good afternoon and welcome. Thank you so much for coming this afternoon. One of the things that's been worrying us here at Copenhagen University in the Sustainability Science Center and in the network of researchers in developing countries, KUU-land, is that there's not enough interest in and not enough focus on the Sustainability Development Goals, which is why it's wonderful to see so many of you here today. And I think one of the things we don't realize, at least in the general public, and certainly not in the political discussion about the Sustainable Development Goals, is that something very, very, very important and very, very different happened in 2015 when the Sustainable Development Goals were negotiated and accepted. And what do I mean by that? Well, in order to explain it, I need to use this picture. And I don't have to introduce this picture because I know you've all seen it before. I've been told it's the picture that's been most downloaded from the net. And there's one thing about this picture that is so obvious that you've never really stopped to think about it or worry about it. And that is the fact that there's no umbilical cord. Of course there's no umbilical cord. What's she talking about? But what are the consequences of not having an umbilical cord? The consequences are twofold. One, it means that when we've used the resources that we get rich on, and it is the Earth's resources that we've developed our prosperity on, when we've used them, there's no more. It also means that when we throw things out, there's nowhere for them to go. I laugh often when I see a 1956, and no, I do not remember it, a 1956 cover picture from Life magazine, which shows a typical American family, father, mother, two children, one boy, one girl, jumping up in the air with glee and throwing from them plastic with the headline that plastic saves time. Understood, plastic saves money. Now, to be perfectly honest, it wouldn't have been rocket science to ask the question, but where does the plastic go when you throw it away? Now, 60 years later, we're all very surprised to find out that much of it's ending up in the ocean. Duh. And I really feel that science and the academic community has in many ways failed society by not looking ahead and not asking those questions. But as obvious as it is that this planet has no umbilical cord and therefore can't get any resources, it was not until the adoption of the Sustainable Development Goals that we got an international convention that even implicitly, it doesn't directly say it, but implicitly acknowledges the fact that our resources are finite, that they are limited. And this totally changes the narrative. And in my eyes, the Sustainable Development Goals can be boiled down to two things. One, an acceptance of the fact that our resources are limited. And two, and most importantly, how are we going to share those resources among the soon to be 9 or 10 billion human inhabitants of this planet? So today, we have the pleasure of having Mogens Lykketoft give an address of about 40 minutes, followed by three very short pieces, or very short responses, from where three of us ask, and it's myself, it's Stig Jensen, and it is Kristen Lund, and we will be asking, what can we do as a society or as a community of individuals to help implement these? We're taking our starting point as a university community, but I hope in the question and answer that follows afterwards, we can broaden it out to what can we all do to implement the Sustainable Development Goals. So, it's now time to turn over to our star attraction. I'm sure I don't really need to introduce him, but Mogens Lykketoft is an economist and a politician, and he's been in the Danish Parliament since 1981. He served as the Minister for Taxation, for Finance, and for Foreign Affairs for his party, the Social Democratic Party, and he was a Speaker of the Parliament. But most importantly, in the context of today, he was in 19... in 2015 and 16, President of the United Nations General Assembly. And that means he was sitting at the end of the board table, or standing, or whatever one does in that situation, when the Sustainable Development Goals were negotiated and accepted. So it is a very great honor and pleasure, Mogens, to have you here today, and we look very much forward to hearing what you have to tell us.
Well, thank you very much for the invitation. I'll try to summarize what it's all about, even if Katherine did it much briefer than I will be able to do it in this presentation already. Well, first question is, what is the situation of this world? It's very contradicting remarks you can make, because never before have so many people a better life and a longer life, better health, more education, and live in peace, more people than ever before. Technology is in very, very rapid speed providing us with new tools to solve the challenges we're facing. But we are also at a turning point where the hope about future is changed to a fear about the future, where the number of conflicts, humanitarian catastrophes, natural catastrophes is exploding, where there is a growing reaction against inequality in wealth, in prosperity, in power, and the economic theories about the free play of the market, Washington consensus, neoliberal thinking, and the non-attention towards increasing inequality in this development has created the financial crisis and an extreme inequality both within countries increasing and between countries. We are living in a world where a few dozen dollar billionaires owe more than the poorest half of humanity, the poorest 3.5 billion people on this world. And we see a liberal world order which was 25 years ago defined by some as the end of history are challenged by low growth, nationalism, xenophobia, and so on. And maybe that's one of my points in all these discussions. Historians can explain more about the state of the world than neoliberal economists, because there is a pre-revolutionary rebellious situation focused against the power elite and the result they have produced over the last decades, which can explode into new popular movements. We saw it in the United States. We saw two revolutionary movements. One was Bernie, the other one was Donald. Very, very different movements. One saying the answer to the challenges, the instability, the discontent, is to try to build societies like they did in the Nordic countries. That was Bernie. And the other one is the reaction to crisis, not that different from the reactions we saw in the 30s, building walls against the outside world, both physical and in other ways, extreme national egoism, denial of the fact that none of the existential threats we are facing can be solved behind the border, national borders of any country. be it the climate, the sustainability in general, be it terrorism or proliferation of weapons and mass destruction and so on. It's very interesting that you had the same two models where one being more inclusive, create a better social balance within countries and between countries, and the other one trying to put the responsibility on the minorities, on the outsiders and so on. We saw both of them in the 30s as well. Actually, I always found it very symbolic that on the 30th of January 1933, two things happened in this on this continent. The one thing was that Stauning, the Social Democratic Prime Minister, made a big step forward for the welfare state in the so-called Kanzlergelder agreement, and that the same night Adolf Hitler was elected Reich Chancellor in Germany. The frightening thing is also that the reaction right now, at least in the United States, against the establishment was so strong that from all the opinion polls I saw during my stay in the US up to the election, if the Democrats had elected Bernie Sanders, he would have been president of the United States of America right now. But for many people, it was just to elect the candidate that was different from the well-known establishment. In this situation, on this background, what to do about the United Nations? The United Nations was created to solve, to save future generations from the scourge of war, as it's written in the UN Charter. We've had 70 years with relatively much peace. We have had a United Nations where all governments actually meet, nearly so, and have to talk to each other. We have funds and programs and organizations working very supportingly for the development where more people live longer and better lives. And we have peacekeeping operations which will actually have actually contained more conflicts than before, but not being able to contain those where the major powers don't agree. And then we have the United Nations as the forum of creating norms for the future development of this world community, this international community. We had the Millennium Development Goals as forerunner for the program of sustainable development. We had the Millennium Development Goals, which were about reducing to half the number of poor people in poor countries. And that we did within 15 years, from 20 to 2015. But the other side of the coin was that most of it happened in China, and most of it happened in an economic model which the Chinese also nowadays recognize was totally unsustainable. So that's a very good starting point to tell about the SDGs, the Sustainable Development Goals, and we better get them clearer on the wall here. The SDGs has to be understood on exactly the background I just mentioned. Be understood at the background that since the day in January 1946 when I was born, and by incidence, the day before the first General Assembly of the United Nations met in London on the 10th of January, since that, we are three times as many people living on this globe. Three times as many people. Each of us in a very, very, very unequal distribution, taking out more capital from the globe than each of us did when we were only one third of the numbers we are now. That's the one fact. The other fact is that the way of life we have in this corner of the world is only similar to the way of life of about 10 to 15, depending on definitions, 10 to 15% of humanity. And it's very easy to understand from the state of this globe right now that if just a couple of billion more people in Asia and elsewhere reach out for the same way of life we have, we know two things for sure. They cannot get it and we cannot keep it. We have to do it differently. If we want to live in a more harmonic, a more sustainable, a more peaceful world, we cannot walk forward along the paths we have followed in the past 15 years or the past 70 years. The Sustainable Development Goals are a demand for a revolutionary change in our way of producing and consuming and distributing goods and services on this globe. It's a message that we cannot eradicate extreme poverty, not only bringing it down to half as we have done up to 2015, but we cannot eradicate extreme poverty by following a path that is socially, economically, and environmentally non-sustainable. And therefore, by the help of a very engaged civil society, millions of people discussing what is it to be about this, this was maybe the Danish version, we have the English version, yeah. What is to do? How is the look of this revolution? It's a message that you can't separate economic, social, and environmental sustainability. That could have been 12 or 24 different goals defined because they are overlapping. But the basic message is not that there are just 17. The message is that the basic challenges we are facing are interdependent to a very, very high degree. That we cannot eradicate extreme poverty, we cannot eradicate hunger, we cannot create education and health services for each and every member of the human race if we don't combine it very, very, very tight with the fight against the appalling inequalities and the fight against environmental catastrophes and climate change. And why is that? Among these 17 goals, you cannot say one is more important than the other. As I said, they are very much interlinked. What happened there? Did I do something? Well, here we go again. But it's obvious that in order to eradicate poverty, you also have to reduce inequalities, and you have to create not only general less inequality, you have to create a much better gender balance, because the gender inequality is a very huge and important part of the present inequalities in this world. And you have to deal with all the issues that has to do with the environment and climate, because maybe these are not all of them equally unequally important. They are independent, as I said, but the fact is that there is much more urgency about the climate point than on all the others. Why is that? That is, because a rather unified scientific community tells us that if we don't act now, we may not be able to stop accelerating climate change. And if we are not able to stop accelerating climate change, we will know that within decades from now, it's not 65 million people being displaced on this globe, as we have right now, the largest number since World War II, but maybe hundreds and hundreds of millions of people pushing to other hundreds and hundreds of millions of people because of the consequences of climate change, because of rising sea levels, desertification, melting down of the glaciers, providing fresh water for 1 billion people, and so on. And it doesn't take that much of imagination to understand that if it's hundreds and hundreds of millions of people pushing to other hundreds and hundreds of millions of people, what you get is more conflicts, more armament, and you get a development which is unstable and soaking up, swallowing up all the resources we dreamed of for eradicating poverty, hunger, creating education and health services. So we have to act on climate change now, and that's why it is so important that is the one of the 17 goals where we not only have a good story, a political commitment, a moral obligation, but we have binding agreements on how to go forward, because we got in Paris in December 2015 the most important leap forward in the climate action plan we have had at any point of time. It's not enough, but it was a very important, great leap forward. And it was also a story telling us, yes, with even somewhat more strong political commitment combined with the exploding rapidity in technological developments, we may be able to stabilize climate change at the 2 degrees Celsius increase compared with the pre-industrial age, or even get it down to 1.5%. That was a very important step forward. I walked, as president of the General Assembly, I walked around in Paris in December, talking to a number of people among the most important conscious negotiators, and asking questions. Well, we know we have to have a global consensus on this. How do you include the Gulf states and other skeptic nations in this? How do we get the global consensus we didn't get in Copenhagen in 2009? And the uniform answer I got from each and everyone was, either the US will take care of that, or China will take care of that. They will round them up. Because when things moved so much in Paris for the first time, it was because of a common understanding between the United States of America and China, as the two major economies in this world and the two major motors in world economy. And that was what actually happened. When Laurent Fabius finally gaveled the agreement, only Nicaragua said they were maybe not on board, but nobody listened to them. So we got the consensus. And that was very important. But this is challenged, of course. This that led me to leave in September the UN in a rather optimistic mood. On the one side, yes, the UN has not been able to solve all the conflicts. There are a lot of humanitarian crises and conflicts. But on the other hand, we have got an agreement. We have an understanding. We have a common understanding about what the future of this world is all about. And then the Trump earthquake happened. And suddenly, one of the two driving machineries stopped working. And that, of course, has led to a lot of pessimism. There are many things we don't know now. But what we know is that the rest of the world has reconfirmed its commitment to go on with the agreements we made in Paris in December 2015. We did that in Marrakesh in November this year, just after the election in the US. And what we also know, and that's a very important argument on the positive side, is, as I touched upon it a moment ago, technology is developing so rapidly. The most pressing issue on climate and environment is to have a clear perspective of eradicating the use, of stopping the use of fossil energies before 2050. And that is supported by an extremely high speed of developing wind and solar energies. I had a conversation as President of the General Assembly with the Indian Prime Minister in New Delhi about what this should be about for a huge developing country like India. And he was very much aware that we are at a turning point, having reduced the cost of solar cells with 80%, I think, within the last four or five years. It would be cheaper for him to provide energy for all the tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands of villages without electricity by solar energy than by coal or oil-fueled plants and building distributing nets. And that's where we are about to go now. And this will, it's very important that this technological development, this reduction of costs in sustainable, renewable energies will continue in the future and be the basis of the rapid transition. And the understanding that this discussion about energy is not longer as it was most of my lifetime, are there or not out there at the bottom of the sea or the bottom of the earth, but that we, whatever we find, have to stop taking it out at 2050. And we have now the perspective that we can get the energy we need, the more energy we need for development in a sustainable way. But of course, this about energy and climate, about the whole agenda of sustainable development, has a number of conditions to be fulfilled. We need strong partnerships between states, cities, regions, municipalities, investing in quite a new infrastructure, and the private sector investing even much more of their money in sustainable investments. And we need a strong global civil society and local civil society to push for this to happen, together with what I experienced from Addis in the summer of 2015 over New York, when we adopted the Sustainable Development Goals in Paris, and the meetings about implementation I organized as President of the General Assembly. We have already a very strong progressive international business community wanting to do this. Many of them coming up on the standing on the chairs, shouting to the governments, telling the governments, you have to provide the framework that makes it obvious for us and for our shareholders that investing sustainable is the best business. And here we need governments to act. Not only with the investments they have to take part in, often in private-public partnerships with in new energy provision and in changing the traffic systems of the cities and the handling of the garbage and whatever, but also in creating the framework for the markets that supports the sustainable responsibility, both for investors in the business community, in the pension funds, in the capital funds, and for the consumers. And what is that about? It's obviously very much about realizing that all markets are regulated in some way. Some are not that regulated, very little regulated, some are very much regulated, some is badly regulated, some is good regulated, but all markets are regulated. And now we have to make the regulations that makes it obvious that the sustainable investment is the best investment. That's about demanding or forbidding certain behaviors, but it's even more about the incentives we create in our industrial policy and in our taxation policy. It's about understanding that Connie Hedegaard has expressed it very, very simple. We have to tax more the behavior which we don't like and to tax less the behavior we want to promote. It's obvious that we have to tax fossil fuels more in order to make this going, but much more is going to happen. You have to think it through in very many aspects, but if we want a more circular economy, we also have to think about making it relatively cheaper to repair things and demanding that products are more long-lasting and so on. There's a lot of very, very revolutionary thinking needed here. And we also need to engage insurance companies in actually pricing the risk of investing non-sustainable, because that will be very helpful for getting the rest of the business community on board. And then we need, of course, developing financial models with the support of the World Bank and regional developing banks and private financial institutions to facilitate this huge new investment of thousands and billions of dollars in a more sustainable infrastructure. As well as we need in particular to direct support to a much larger amount to the poorest of countries if they should ever be able to take part in this transition. We have committed to do that. We did it in Addis in the Conference on Financing of Development in mid-2015. We did it in Paris when we agreed upon the climate action plan. But much is not done yet. Even some countries, don't mention anyone, are reducing development assistance right now, which is exactly the wrong way of going if we should ever should be able to get along on this, the poorest of countries. But development assistance is many different things. And maybe not to devaluate the necessity of increasing more or less traditional development assistance, maybe change it somewhat more over to support for more sustainable government structures, fight against corruption, creating stronger, more efficient tax systems in poor countries. All that is very important. And the whole global effort to contain and reduce tax evasion and tax havens is extremely important to make it possible both for poor and rich countries to get the resources for the necessary investment from the public sector in this enormous transition we are going to have. And of course, the major problem with, in particular, the Trump administration right now is that they are certainly not in the process of strengthening the regulations to support this development. They are certainly not creating extra resources to the poorer countries and the United Nations in order to make this done. And that's a problem, and that's a challenge for all of us who are still committed to make this great design happen globally. But on the other hand, and that's what the best of my American friends say when we have stopped talking about the misery of election of Donald Trump. They say, yes, but even in the Republican-governed oil state of Texas, there are more investment in renewable energies than in oil right now. The markets are working with us, and at some point, somebody will convince the businessman Trump that this is a good business case. One can hope. But it's interesting that up till now, the process of getting the Sustainable Development Goals accepted and the Paris Agreement signed and the following election in the United States has placed China very much in the forefront in this global development. And what we need is extremely high degree of more European and Danish engagement in this implementation. And it's very sad that exactly at this point of time where Europe was, Denmark in particular, in very, very many areas in the forefront, leaders, heads of states and government are totally concentrated on Brexit and refugees and Turkey, whatever, and not taking the necessary decisions to keep Europe at the front line in fighting for the sustainable development, I would say, together with China, a China that has realized, whatever you feel about the system over there, has realized that exactly the economic model they have tried to copy and take an industrial development that took 300 years in our part of the world and make it within 30-some years, showed exactly why they were forced to change course and go into a much more sustainable way of producing and consuming. Much could be said about consumers' habits and how to change them. I can't help using just a few minutes to make one very good illustration. We got at the Davos World Economic Forum last year. There is a tradition that in the World Food Program tent, the VIPs will be served a dinner at one of the days. And this year, this past year, it was the former chef of Obama who made the dishes. And what happened was that every second of us got a huge beef, very delicious. The other half got a small piece of chicken with very delicious arrangement also. And then he came in and said, I just made this to remember you about the fact that the beef took 6 times as much water and 6 times as much CO2 emission as the chicken. So maybe if we as consumers should contribute, shouldn't stop eating meat, but we should change somewhat our habits to contribute to something that's possible for all of humanity within this small globe. Remember, that's not what he said, but that's what we know. If every Chinese would ask for as much meat on his dish as we have, it would be all the meat produced on this globe now. All of it. So even if we wait for the market reactions to take over, we will at some point rather soon experience an extremely rising price on meat. And that's good for changing behavior. Eating small pieces, like the Japanese, or whatever. But this is just one of thousand examples you could mention of how we as individual consumers also have to think about what we do in order to make it possible for this sustainable development to happen. And you can ask, what more can we do in this corner of the world? We certainly cannot rest on the successes we had. We have to underpin, support the good positions we have. We are strong in many of the products and technologies that's needed for the rest of the world also in order to make this happen. And we should, and we have promoted them by at an early stage having high demands to ourselves about the transformation from an unsustainable to a sustainable development. And we should certainly not rest there and say, well, we are so much in the forefront now, others have to do more. Others have to do more, but we should maintain being in the forefront. We should explore very much more where we are not in the forefront and have to do more. But we have still all the good conditions to both make profit for ourselves and for the global future by being the forward-acting country in changing energy supply to renewables and all kinds of technological developments, and support that, as I said, through our regulations, our taxation systems, and our incentives for business. And first of all, we have to increase the public awareness and the political activism in order to make more politicians think more about the next generation than on the next election. Or, with other words, make them understand that we are the majority that think that you can only get our vote to win the next election if you think the next generation. That's the positive way of expressing it. And that takes some political activism from all of us, from all of you. And to summarize all of it, I will quote my good friend, the now former Deputy Secretary General of the United Nations, Jan Eliasson from Sweden, who always said at the end of this kind of presentations, "We have no plan B because we have no planet B." That's what it's all about. And let me say, well, what happened here? No. Yeah, I just say, but I can't reach this. You can read this book. We wrote about our work in the UN. I have a few copies here. You can buy them from me, but otherwise you can get it at a higher price at the bookstore next door. Okay, here we go. I finish now.
Thank you very much, Mogens. On our behalf, I have to say that three major messages came through, actually four, but the three major messages were, one, you say there's no such thing as a free economy. I happen to agree, but I'm a little surprised that you survived as long as you did in New York. There's a reason why I moved to Denmark. The other major message that came, one of the other major messages that came through is that the SDGs, by definition, are for all of us. And there is no country in the world, including Denmark, that actually has met all of the SDGs now. So we don't talk about it very much in Denmark, but we're missing points on all of the SDGs. And for those of you who might be interested, another book advertisement. Steen Hildebrandt was editor on a book here where a group of people, academics, this is what I want to talk about, the role of people at universities in the implementation of the SDGs, have tried to analyze what is the situation for Denmark with respect to all of the SDGs. And that's Jif's forlag, or Jif's publishing that I can recommend there. Another point that you came across very strongly to me with was the fact that the SDGs are integrated. I mean, they have a musketeer oath between them. It's all for one and one for all, which means you can't simply say, well, we're a little country, we'll choose four and concentrate on four. I mean, they do hang together. And this is actually a problem in terms of the role of universities and education, because we don't hang together very well either. And I think there are probably many cases that silo thinking actually prevents us from getting the co-benefits that we could get out of actually achieving these achieving these goals. But one of our major jobs at a university is education, and as I say, we've analyzed it, there are very many studies at this university and the other universities in Denmark which are very relevant to these goals, but it hasn't really been publicized yet in their titles. So I talk to students and they say, but you know, where are the courses? I want to learn something, I want to do something, and that hasn't been the content that we've been bringing out most. So we're actually trying to go through now and to find the different courses that are relevant and what they're relevant to and mark them in a way that they can be seen. But we also, this summer, and I need the next slide, this summer we're running a course, and this is mostly for businesses and ministerial people, as a societal decision makers, a course in the summer university on how the Sustainable Development Goals are being enacted in different companies and how they can strategically be used. And Mogens has very kindly also agreed to give a talk there. It's the Sustainability Science Center doing it together with Steen Hildebrandt. And we have there, we have Novozymes, Novo Nordisk, Arla, Maersk. I probably shouldn't have started mentioning them because I've left some people out. But there are a lot of companies that are coming to say how they do it. There are different ways to look at implementing them. None of them are necessarily right or wrong, but we can learn from each other. Another example we have here is that we have, together with the Sustainable Science Center, together with CBS and DTU, have developed two electives that can be used in a lot of different studies. And the reason we did it together was we said, okay, here at the Copenhagen University, we're really good at describing problems. At DTU, they're really good at developing metrics to be able to measure yourself against these problems. And at CBS, they're actually very good at getting some of this knowledge into value chains, into business models, and so on. So by following these electives, you can come all the way around. CBS and DTU students are able to sign up directly at their universities, but the reason I bring it up here today, if there are Copenhagen University students, if you want to apply for the courses, you have to apply for credit transfer at your own study boards before the 15th of May. I dare guarantee you'd be accepted on the course. You don't have to worry about that. You have to get your study board to accept it, because Copenhagen University doesn't actually the course itself, it uses the other universities to do it. And finally, if you have a good idea to how, it doesn't have to be technology, it can be in any aspect, any of these changes, this revolution that Mogens says that we need. Revolutions are made up of small steps, and student projects are often small steps, and there's this competition called Grønlyst, and there's a deadline coming up here, the deadline for us, to for the UP, for the Copenhagen University students, is the 1st of May to submit, and you can get more information on our website here. So there are lots of ways in which we are trying to, at least on the educational, well, not only not only on the research side, because obviously new knowledge is necessary to make a revolution, but we are trying to get this into the educational side of things, and please contact us if you have any questions about these or other courses or what could be done. And with that, I'm going to give the word over to Stig Jensen, who's coming from the Faculty of Theology, for a few words on what we can do, how research can support this revolution.
Yeah, thank you. I have to say that in Copenhagen University, we are not really doing political activism, and we are not really doing revolutions. But and I also have to say the classical way of doing research is actually where we know more and more about less and less. But again, I also want to say that all the goals here, Copenhagen University is actually doing research here in all these areas here. So in many ways, as a knowledge-producing community, we have actually something to contribute here. And I think when we talk about contributing to these things, I think it's also quite important to relate to what we have done in recent years at Copenhagen University to have cooperation on cross-faculty level. For example, we have an initiative called Copenhagen University Developing Countries, KU-land, where we have all faculties represented discussing making cooperation about developing countries issues. Another initiative that we have is the Sustainability Science Center. Again, it's cross-faculty cooperation. And in relation to many of these things, it's very important to have these kinds of cooperations, not only between researchers, but also between researchers and the rest of communities around. I also want to say something particular in relation to goal number 4, quality education. That's one of our really important things. And of course, you know, our aim is to become world class, but our aim is also to work with quality education, not only in Denmark, but also on a global level. And what we have done in recent years, with the support of ministries and private funds, is actually twinning arrangement with other education institutes. And I think that's one of the areas where we can really do something. What we often have this idea in Denmark is that we can learn, we can actually give a lot of knowledge and capacity building to the global south. But what I also have to say is we can actually learn a lot from the global south. So this training arrangement is extremely important, not only for Copenhagen University's aim to become world class or getting even better, but for in order to achieve all these goals here. So that will be my intervention. Thank you.
Okay, can you hear me? Right. I want to strike a blow for what you might call irrelevant and irreverent research. There is no shortage of well-intended programs to improve mankind in history. Programs that have been rammed through by governments at the cost of lives and livelihoods of ordinary people. All well-intended policies, family planning, land use planning, and of late, climate policies. Let me just give you one example. There's this program that has been running for a few years now called RED, Reduction of Emissions from Deforestation and Degradation, which basically says we need to stop cutting down trees, let's pay governments in poor countries to keep the forests alive. Sounds very good. So you transfer a lot of money to governments, who then tell people who live in these forests, look, by the way, these forests are not yours anymore, these are not your trees, they are for the good of mankind. So under the cover of doing something really nice in terms of climate policy and climate intervention, you dispossess large masses of poor people. All of these 17 goals, I think they're fine. But the devil is in the details. How are they implemented? And I think we need if we can contribute anything as researchers at the university level, it is to be critical and irreverent, not take the stated facts as truth. Projects like this, like these red projects, they basically at local level decide what is property and what is crime. Right? These are important issues, and they all fit. These projects fit very well into these goals. In the brochures, it looks like we're really doing something for climate. But who's paying? Whose trees were they? I think we need to ask these questions. I also think we need to ask the question about with whom and for whom do we do research? Governments are very good at working with governments. Universities are slightly more flexible. We work with universities, but also with other agents in society. And I think we have an obligation to work with people who are critical in their own countries, people who are obnoxious, people who are difficult, people who are inconvenient. Otherwise, I don't think we live up to our responsibility. I think we have a responsibility to produce knowledge, even if it's inconvenient to those who want to do good. Thank you.
Thanks very much. Super question.
Do you want us to be here? Or?
Yeah, I think we should all be up here, yeah.
Right.
And I think your points there are very well taken, not least of which because you wouldn't have that red problem if you really followed the Musketeer Oath and mm-hmm. were looking at the well-being and the economic growth and all that sort of thing at the same time. So I think you made a really, really good point there. Now, with that intervention, where we were trying to bring things down to you know, what are we actually doing? What can we do? I'd like to open the floor to questions to Mogens or good ideas or whatever. Yes, please tell us who you are when you.
Included once more. And this international transportation and transportation in general is one of the big challenges we have on the globe. So I have a question. Where in these sustainable development goals can you see some fingerprint of transportation? And can we hope for, Katherine, that in the future you make a conference on sustainable transportation?
Well, the changing of traffic patterns and traffic systems, transportation systems, is a very, very important part of ever thinking of a sustainable development. We've come a long way with energy. We are not that long when we talk about transportation or for that, agriculture. Those are the big issues we are going to face in the coming years. I mean, there is a lot thinking going on, I think, in particular in major cities about how to change the transportation systems to metro lines and so on, and limit the use of private cars. The whole technological development and organizational development around cars, I think, is a very interesting part of this, because I think you will see a very rapid change to, not that much to the self-driving cars in the beginning, but to people not possessing cars, but sharing cars in a much, much more strong way than they do nowadays, not only because of environment and climate, but also because major cities are already all too congested. It's much easier, that I realize every morning here in Copenhagen, to go by bicycle or train than go by car. So there will be a rapid development here, of course, as in every other issue included in the goals, you can push that forward through regulations and taxation, including, of course, the transition to electric cars, which will at some point will also have an exploding reduction in costs, and therefore be possible to expand. And then there, of course, there is the shipping, which is very, very short version of the story is, of course, you can make it less energy consuming. You can also, to a certain degree, use renewable tools to some of the energy in shipping transportation. But you also have there to get the real cost of fossil energies for the global future in transportation. That, of course, will also change the pattern of how many products do you pick from the other side of the world, and which kind of products do you pick from the other side of the world, and what will you produce in a near environment in the future. That will change.
And if I could just add on to that, I mean, I think you asked where you find them there, and I heard you say international transport. Obviously, it's hiding under climate. The problem is that we don't, I mean, you all probably know that these 17 goals have 178 sub-goals, I think is the number.
Yep.
And some of them are missing metrics, and we're still struggling with the Kyoto metrics where we don't really have a metric for the international transport. So that is a very real problem that needs to be tackled. But I'd like to reiterate Mogens' comment that agriculture is just as big a problem. If you look at Denmark, the EU has a goal that we reduce in the EU by 80 to 95% our emissions in 2050 vis-a-vis 1990. There's no reason to believe that Denmark should get away with less than the average. So let's say we have to do an 80% reduction. In 1990, 16% of our emissions came from transport and 16% from agriculture. That's 32%. We cannot get an 80 to 95% reduction without going into those two sectors. And believe it or not, agriculture has actually reduced since 1990. But everything they've reduced has been lost by gains in emissions, increases in emissions on the transport side. So we're playing a zero-sum game with agriculture and transport at the time, and we don't really accept that fact. With respect to me holding a sustainable transport Congress, I don't think so. But I was at a meeting this morning with some other people who are planning one, so I guarantee you there will be a focus on this area.
Yes, my name is Ben Wieland. I was born at the same time as Mogens. The population has tripled since then. This time last year when Professor Sachs was here, I asked the same question that I will ask of you. You say that all these 17 are equally important. I raise the question. Area number three, the health thing. I asked where family planning was. And Dr. Sachs says, well, it is under the subclause, because it was UN wording, reproductive health care services. Now that President Trump has got funding for overseas services on family planning in the third world, how are we going to cope with this?
Your question is very, very relevant. There's not much talk in the United Nations about family planning because it's one of the most controversial issues we are facing. If you have the whole global scene and what Trump has just announced of cutting in family programs that in any way directly or indirectly support abortion is terrible. And that's one of the areas where the rest of us has to stand up and provide the necessary resources, at least to continue what the United Nations are actually doing and allowed to do now. But it would be denial to say that the increase in population, number of children in poor families and poor countries is not part of the problem. It is a huge part of the problem. But the question is, what kind of policies will you actually be allowed to pursue in this very important area? I think we have to rely very much on campaigning, and we have to hope that this wonderful Pope we have on all the other issues, one of the very strong moral authorities with a constituency of 1.3 billion people, actually arguing for the Sustainable Development Goals in a very, very strong way, that he will also be able to change at least somewhat the Catholic Church attitude towards family planning. He was about to say, I don't think he wanted to be quoted, but he was quoted for saying something in an airplane after leaving a crowd of 5 million in the Philippines, saying, well, yes, it's good to have many children, but maybe you could have little less than the men.
Just want to sort of add a little bit to this, because this is, of course, a very important topic, as you sort of mentioned. But I think if we look at it from an African perspective where I work, I can sort of see some really interesting things going on at the moment. If you look in the rural areas, you know, getting children is an insurance. Mm-hmm. It's actually something, it benefits you in the future because somebody will take care of you. So we see in rural areas actually that there are big families. Although they are smaller now than before, they're big families because it's an insurance. If we look at sort of people in urban areas in Africa, the families are very small because it's a cost. It's very costly to have children in big cities. So when we look at the pattern there, things is actually changing quite rapidly in Africa in the positive direction. Of course, we have the problem of very young people. In generally, lots of people in Africa, you know, large proportion of the people of Africa is actually under 20 years. And of course, there will be some problems also in the future. But they're working with these things. So I think more than campaign, but also creating security for people in rural areas is actually a key thing. Then they might not get as many children.
Well, yes, if I may add a comment, it's obvious that we know from all mechanisms, all changes, also what happened in the past century in this part of the world, and what, from before to after their family program, which is now disappearing gradually, that when people change lifestyle and there's more security, more urbanization, the number of children go down. Mm. Even in a Catholic country like Mexico, they went in a very short span of time from 7 children on average to 2, like we have. Mm. But talking about Africa, in 35 years, there will be twice as many people in Africa as there is now, which is surely a problem. Just think of what affects us in the unauthorized movement of people. It will be overwhelming if we are not able to rise the living standards, both in the land and in the cities of Africa. But it is a huge part of the problem, and we talk all too little about it because of the Islamic, the Catholic, the American Evangelical Church, and so on. That's what it is.
David Miller, and I work with climate change issues. I'm with the SAMHSA Energy Academy. I'm also with Democrats Abroad. Regarding the reproductive rights and the Trump administration, in developing countries and the Trump administration cutting that money, Canada announced last week that they're going to be spending $650 million Canadian dollars on that effort to make up for the loss from the United States. That's Justin Trudeau. One comment or suggestion is that regarding the United States over the next 4 years, it's probably best to work with regions and states. So for instance, New England, you're from New England, California, Hawaii, Colorado, et cetera. Yeah. And I think the United Nations should actually work, sort of like with the C40, you know, cities and whatever, but to work with those regions directly and just forget about Washington, because Washington is a mess for the next 4 years. And I just have one question for Mogens here, and that's regarding number 8, the economic growth. Because, like, within climate change and other issues, we feel that economic growth is a contributor, for instance, to climate change. if you consider what we've experienced up to now with economic growth. In other words, maybe it should be more economic balance or balanced growth or however you want to put it, but just growth itself often leads to a lot of other problems.
Yeah, that's a very important question. I remember, and I think that's the key formulation you have to have on this. I remember what we wrote already back in 1977, where one of the program principles for my party, the Social Democrats, I participated in writing over the years. We wrote, inspired by the Club of Rome and their discussion about limitations for growth already in the 70s, we wrote, there are limits for quantitative growth, but there are no limits for growth in quality. Meaning that if we can recircle, if we can economize with natural resources and fossil fuels and so on, we can have growth. And much of the growth will actually be in services where we are already pretty good in education, health, old age care, kindergartens, whatever, where there's no very strong connection between use of the quantitative growth and the qualitative growth. So I think we have to think in that way and understand, yes, we have to have less growth in eating meat, we have to have less growth in using our non-growth in using minerals and so on and so forth, but we can have a growth that increases the living conditions, the life quality of people.
Yeah, hi, Mogens, hello. My name is Samantha. I work at the Irish Mission. Back when we were having the discussions, I was supporting the PR and doing the consultations. I'm Latin American myself. So I have a more general question. It's not regarding one of the goals. Actually, there was a lot of discussions about there was redundancy and why we needed so many goals and hundreds of targets. And I wanted to know your perspective of, in terms of finance and attracting and engaging multilateral banks, the World Bank, and doing private partnerships, why do we need to depict those goals? They're highly correlated. Some could say they're somewhat are redundant, but there is a point in making them separately, so whenever you're focusing in one, you don't mess up with other four. How do you think having those 17 goals and so many targets will help focusing, bringing more resources, technical and financial resources, to the achievement of the goals?
Well, difficult question. I mean, what we have to do is always to keep in mind the relations between the different goals. If we are investing energy in going forward on one goal, we have to make sure that we're doing it in a way that's not conflicting with reaching the other goals. And that's why it's very good to have the whole picture all the time. You have to have the whole picture all the time. But you also have to realize, of course, that if you act on climate, if you act on energy, you act on climate. If you act on inequality and gender equality, you promote health and quality education, you reduce poverty and hunger and so on. You have to see the interconnections and all of it. And I think it's a very good way of expressing both the limitations of the globe, as Katherine started with, and the interdependency of all the challenges we are meeting. We haven't talked that much about I talked about the partnerships. This is not for governments alone. It's really for consumers, producers, investors, and cities and regions, local governments, as you said, should do it. And if we don't, regional developing banks and the World Bank and all the systems we have to interact in partnerships, because it's certainly not done by governments alone, and if this was only written by 193 governments, it would not have been as ambitious as it is. That's one point. The other point is the interaction with peace, justice, and strong institutions. Goal 16 is so important in understanding that you need, in order to avoid conflicts, you need justice and strong institutions. In order to reduce poverty and hunger, you have to end the conflicts. But because maybe we reduce the number of very poor people even in the years to come, but we will never eradicate extreme poverty if you don't end the conflicts. Because an increasing part of the extreme poor people in this world are exactly in the conflict-torn regions and neighboring countries.
But would it not be fair, Mogens, to say that there's nothing magical about the number 17? It could have been more, it could have been less. And I think as negotiations went on, people thought 17 was too many. But how do you decide what's going to go? Because everybody's fighting. So I mean, this is, I mean, I'm a marine biologist, so I know nothing about negotiation. But I think this was where this was where you could end. But obviously, you can argue that it should be.
But I think it's also something that's building from the Millennium Development Goals. So there you had 8 goals. And then you sort of say, okay, is there more goal we need? And then again, it's in the UN, so you have to make these compromises here. And I think also when we talk about the Millennium Development Goal, and you also mentioned, Mogens, that there the focus has mainly been on goal number one, the goal about halving poverty. And the focus has been with the Millennium Development Goal have been on the Global South. The idea is this, it's not only the Global South, but it's globally. So it's some of these progresses and the negotiation between different actors. So this is a compromise.
Yes, of course, there are no such thing as an objective number of 17. But I think with these 17 goals and all the goals and targets underneath, we have covered it all. We have shown the interdependence, and we have explained the walk away from the Millennium Goals, where we had not the focus on gender equality and reduced inequalities. We were more or less locked into the trickling down economy thinking. We had not realized that we could not walk to the end of extreme poverty without interlinking environment and climate. So just for that reason, it is a political compromise. Of course, it's a very beautiful political compromise, I would say, compared with everything else agreed upon in the United Nations over the last 71 years. but it is also an expression of what our prime minister, unfortunately, had totally misunderstood when he was about participating in the gathering of these 17 goals. He went out of the General Assembly Hall and said to the journalists, well, this is not so much about us, it's about the poor countries and the poor people. No, it's not! That's the point of it. The Millennium Goals were about those people alone. This is about all of us, and most of the investment, most of these thousands and thousands of billions of dollars that has to be invested in a different infrastructure on this globe will have to take place exactly here in this part of the world.
I mean, you could imagine if you reduced them down to one, right? I mean, it would become really difficult to hold anybody accountable. The fact that you managed to actually reach 17, I think, is quite amazing. If they then multiply into almost 200 sub-goals, then it becomes difficult to keep people accountable or governments accountable again. But I think, had you reduced it just to one goal, it would have been senseless, right?
Should we move on?
My name is Anne Nguyen. I'm a student here in Copenhagen. And some of you have already touched upon the idea of education and the sustainability development goals, especially how the universities are trying to implement it in their courses and research. But I was also very much interested in the younger generations, the high schoolers and in middle school. And of course, it's very important for them to know about these SDGs, as they are the ones who are most affected by it in the future, at least, and are the ones who's going to carry on all these goals in the future. So I just wanted to know what we could do to create this fundamental base of at least knowledge for them to be more aware of all these goals and appreciate these goals? Like, what could we do in terms of education?
I could probably jump in there and say that I've actually been involved in developing some material for folks for the grade schools and for secondary schools on the SDGs. And I think education, especially around secondary school, the education goal is one where Denmark is doing very, very, very badly. We had, and now I think we might change it, but we had a goal that 95% of our young people should come through a secondary education. There was a hearing a few months ago about, well, wasn't that a little optimistic? And I kept saying, but it says in the goal 100% of everyone in the world, and how for a rich country in Denmark could 95% be too ambitious? And if you look at people coming through secondary, or when they finish ninth grade in Denmark, if you go 7 years from when they finished, and a secondary school education takes 3 years, if you go 7 years, you have an average of 80% have gotten a secondary school education. 84% of the women with a Danish background have gotten it. 79% of the Danish boys, 78% of the girls with other than Danish parents, and only 62% of the boys with other than Danish parents have gotten a secondary education. So this is one of the goals where we are seriously challenged in Denmark at the moment.
If we want to have the younger generation engage in this in this sort of serious way, we also have to not be naive. I mean, all these goals, they're nice, happy colors, it looks like a consensus, right? We can all agree that these are nice, but the implementation will not be consensual. These are all very contentious issues, and it's not just a question of knowledge, it's also a question of interests. This will not be implemented in total agreement. We can decide that these goals are nice and have a consensus about that, but the implementation will not be smooth sailing. And I think if we don't tell kids in high school and primary school that, but just tell them that this is a consensus, that this is just smooth sailing, now we've got the 17 goals and we're just going to move ahead, we're not living up to our responsibility. This is not going to be easy. It's the easy part was to define the 17 goals, right?
But I also just want to add, because I think implementation is very important here. Mm-hmm. The experience from the Millennium Development Goals was that there the focus was primary education. And what you saw there was most of the activities was actually investment was in primary education. So it's a huge improvement that it's more broadly now, that it's not only primary education, also secondary and higher education. And what we see in Africa and many countries in the global south is education is seen as the way forward for a good life. So education is a key thing here.
Let me adjust a sentence to the question of integrating in the curriculum from the basic school and all through the education system the understanding of the 17 goals. I think that's very, very important part of starting this process. If we should ever be successful in implementing, it means that every kid and every student will know that it's also about her or his personal behavior preferences if we should ever be able to reach the sustainable development. So I think, and there I hope, but I'm not sure, I hope that the Danish government with its national plan, which is coming out later this month, I think, will also have this part of it. And I think the School of Architecture and Design made a very beautiful decision last month of integrating this in everything they do in their education, and more school systems could do the same from the basic to the highest.
Hello.
Yes.
My name is Rasmus Vincent. I'm a sustainability coordinator of the folk high schools in Denmark, and I would like to ask all four of you a question about an aspect of the SDGs that is not touched on so much. That is, in the document listing the goals called Transforming Our World, the traditional definition of sustainability that we know from Brundtland has actually been supplemented with something that we are not so familiar with. And I would like to ask you about that, that says that we should not only secure economic and social and environmental sustainability, we should also strive to live in harmony with nature. And I really wonder, what does that mean and what does that imply? So I would like to ask you, I mean, if you think it's a interesting, good thing that we have expanded our understanding of sustainability with this notion, and how to proceed with it from here.
Okay, that's question number one, or comment number one. Number two, yeah.
Yes, my name is Jacob. I'm a student of philosophy. And I didn't quite get one thing. I mean, all these goals sound nice. They sound like we can all agree. But, Mogens, you said something about taxation as a means to achieving these goals. But if we get Trump and probably some other types, some other of the same types all around the world, probably here in Europe too, then how does that work? I mean, we already have tax evasion problems all over the place. If we have more of this inequality in what goals we want to achieve, then
I think it's clear. We've got your question, I think, mm-hmm. And I've got a sort of an answer, but we'll wait until we've gotten these four in, and then we're going to have to stop the party.
Hi, my name is Kiyovi. I'm a student at the Center of African Studies. I have a question about the fact that you, Mogens, you acknowledge the fact that in the future a lot of people will become refugees or migrants because of the climate change happening around the world. How does these goals actually address that problem?
And the last one's right down here.
My name is Torkel Sørensen from University of Copenhagen. I have a question on behalf of my grandchildren. This is about optimism versus pessimism. I actually think we are paying too much attention to Mr. Trump. I mean, why not just neglect what this guy is saying and build on the fundamental understanding of the challenges? And I attended an international meeting a couple of months ago where a talk was given by the vice chair of the International Climate Panel. And he was challenged the same way. And he expressed, to my great surprise, a considerable optimism. He said, no, there's no reason for defeatism here. We are on our way. So I really wanted to hear the panel here, not least Mogens Lykketoft. What are your sense about optimism versus pessimism? What should I transmit to my grandchildren?
Why don't you try first?
Okay. The first question was about what do we mean with live in harmony with nature. I think it's about understanding the limitations of the globe. It's about understanding that we cannot afford to limit the number of species in the speed we are doing. It has to do with the whole regulation of the environment. It has to do with climate change. It has to do with the broader understanding of environmental sustainability than maybe we had in the Brundtland report originally. But of course, we will not be living in harmony with nature in the way that we return to the village and the land, the farmer's life. We'll have more farms in our terraces in the cities, so we don't have to carry around the potatoes and carrots and other good things as long as we do now. But of course, in a world where more than half the number, maybe two-thirds of the population will live in major cities, we will not go back to nature in the original understanding of this. On taxation, of course, we will not reach these goals if there is not revitalized a kind of understanding that the long-term self-interest is not a national one, it's a global one. That none of the problems facing our children and grandchildren will be avoided if we only deal with them within borders, like in the way Trump is dealing with it. That will also take us to the understanding that, yes, talking about migrants and refugees, if we will avoid the waves of migration being totally unmanageable and conflict creating and bringing to power the fascists and nationalists and xenophobics in all the rich countries, it is in our very deep self-interest to pay not more, a little more, for those who are now in hunger in the Horn of Africa or in the Middle East, but much, 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 much more to make it possible for those who are refugees or migrants to live a decent life where they are now. It's a Marshall Plan for Africa to avoid the traffic over the Mediterranean. It's a major investment in the livability of the Middle East after the conflicts, if we would avoid them knocking on our doors in a way we can't manage, even if we wanted to. If we opened up our borders, it would only be for a short time for the very, very dark forces to take over and shut them totally. So what I'm fighting for personally is this understanding, well, maybe, yes, you're right, we can't take all of them within our borders without totally destabilizing our societies and political systems. But if that's the fact, you have an even major obligation and self-interest in supporting much, much more, not less, abroad. That's the point. At least partly the answer of how to manage the increased pressure for global migration. But it is also a question of understanding the need of taxation. Because a major part of what has to be invested in this world in order to make it sustainable is in a totally changed infrastructure and all pillars. And a considerable part of that will by nature be done by the states and the public sector. And there has to be a revenue for the public sector. Yeah. And there has to be a revenue also for the public sector and the poorest of countries, and that's why we have to redistribute through taxes also there. But the fight against tax evasion, I think understanding is increasing that tax evasion, tax havens are a major source to the explosion in inequalities in the Western world in recent decades, and to the underfunding of welfare states and so on. It's not the poor people's demand for social services and social stability that is undermining the budgets. It's the tax evasion of rich companies and rich people. And I think an event like the Panama Papers was beautiful because it showed to every one of us how huge this traffic is and what we have to do about it. And there are actually things going on in better transparency and better tools to deal with this. And it's very, very necessary. Also, in getting the continued acceptance from the majority of us, why should we pay taxes if those who are the most affluent, the most rich people and the most richest companies don't do it? I mean, it's undermining the whole fabric, the whole understanding of kind of solidarity and welfare systems in nationally and internationally, if we can all see that those who are best equipped to pay more don't pay anything. So I think the movement is there, but it's also kind of revolution that has to be pushed forward by active people in and outside the University of Copenhagen. neglect of Trump. I mean, the problem of answering that question is, well, yes, if we had every time we need it, he would disappear, hopefully without disappearing all of us as a result of his politics. But he will disappear. New tools will be developed by technology. There is nothing that cannot be solved in principle. But the problem, as we pointed out in the discussion before, is particularly in climate change, problems, challenges can accelerate so much if we don't act now that it is much, 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 much more costly to deal with them, if even possible to deal with them in a few decades' time. And that's the balance between optimism and pessimism.
If I may add on to that, I would say that I think I made them very unhappy in Deadline a few weeks ago because I was called in there to talk about Trump and climate, and I got in there and I said, I don't think Trump's very interesting in terms of climate. I worry about Trump in terms of civil liberties or civil rights, but I don't worry about him in terms of climate. But I do think, and this is a little plug for the 24th of March when we're going to have our next sustainability lecture, which isn't a lecture per se, but where we get five different people from five different angles to address the question of what does populism, this wave of populism, and that's what Trump is, it's not Trump the person, it's part of this wave of populism, what does it mean in terms of communicating and managing climate change? And we have Vincent Hendricks, we have Martin Lidego, we have Christian Ibsen from Concito, we have Stee, and we have Teresa Scavenius from Institute for States Political Science, who are going to be looking at this problem from different angles. We may simply need to be trying to mobilize the people. I mean, it's not the governments that we expect to make the difference now, or the Trumps, it is the states or whatever. So 1:30, not here, but if you follow our website or get messages from our lectures, there we'll be dealing with that on the 24th of March. And in terms of optimism or pessimism, I have to promise you, I wouldn't use 60 plus hours a week on this if I didn't believe it was possible. So I do think we're in a really, really exciting time in human history. Our ancestors learned they needed to do management at the local level for their own sakes. And then they realized we needed to do management of the environment at the regional level, because if we want clean air and water around us, we can't let the Poles and the Germans dump. And now we're realizing we have to manage at the global level, and we'll figure it out. We probably won't do it till the last minute, but we'll figure it out. So I believe in this. With that, I'd like to draw this this party to a close. Mogens, I'd like to thank you very, very much for using so much time on us. If I may, I will in my future correspondence and communication regarding the SDGs, I will quote you. I thought it was so wonderful when you called them a beautiful compromise. I think that was just that. I think they are, but to hear it coming from the words of someone who's been so close to them, I thought that was great. And we have a tradition here that we thank our speakers with a very sustainable gift that, apropos optimism and pessimism, you can turn the head up and down. It can be very happy or it can be very sad. I suggest you put the beak up.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you for coming.
I had one before, but I gave it to my follower as president of the UN General Assembly for the same reasons.
Oh, God. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.